Dear learners, welcome to e-learning platform. In the previous weeks 1 and 2, you learned a short biography of Sylvia Plath and 3 poems written by her, Daddy, Tulips and Lady Lazarus. And in this week 3, you will learn 4 more poems. In lesson 1, we will learn Morning Song. In lesson 2, Poppies in October. In lesson 3, Ariel, and in lesson 4, Waking in Winter. Lesson 1, Morning Song. First of all, I'll discuss about the summary and then analysis of the poem. Morning Song is one of several poems Sylvia Plath wrote concerning pregnancy, birth and maternal feelings. It is a short poem that highlights the confused reactions of the mother, the speaker Plath, as she tends to the needs of a newborn baby. In this poem, a new mother describes how she feels about a newly born baby. Some of the feelings she expresses are not those we might expect. And the poem is a fascinating exploration of the strangeness of motherhood and how odd it can feel at the beginning to have created a new life. So it's a very simple poem about maternity. The structure of the poem, so now we're in the phase of analysis of this poem. First of all, structure and then poetic devices, and then we discuss about major themes very briefly. This poem is a 6 stanza written in 3 verse, each stanza and rhyme terset making 18 lines in total. Poetic devices are alliteration, assonance, caesura, enjambment, metaphor, personification and simile. Major themes are pregnancy, birth and maternal feelings. The dominant theme in Morning Song is alienation and the process by which it is overcome. The women's poem, it's a feministic poem, all of the poems are feministic, written by Sylvia Plath. The women's poem, it deals with maternal instinct and its awakening. Plath awaits sentimentality in taking up a subject, becoming a mother, that is too often treated in a superficial way. The poem's first word, love, is what we would often associate with the bond between mother and baby. Lesson 2, Poppies in October. This is a poem of flower, poppies, name of flowers, though they are not blossom in October. But here, Plath meant it to be blossomed in October. Why? So that's the contrast between joy and pain, between sorrow and ecstasy, the life and death, male and female. So that's contrast expressed in a natural way. The natural symbol is poppy flowers. This poem is a portrayal of Plath's feelings towards nature. She shows the beautiful contrasts of nature in this poem. Poppies in October is not simple. It is a combination of conflicting feelings of joy and pain. This poem of Plath's is of the time when she used to write more about violence. But this poem is an enhancing and breathtaking beauty of poppy flowers. The bright light of the flower is threatened by the darting rays of the sun. The sun is a symbol of male, and the poppies are the symbol of female. And the petal of poppies are compared by Plath to the skirts of female. The poetess comes up with the beauty of poppies. She comes to a field of blossom poppies. She is overwhelmed with the beauty with the redness of flowers. She says that the sky and the clouds, which makes morning beautiful, have no match with this beauty of poppies. Let's go to the analysis of this poem. Ironically, this poem was written on Plath's last birthday before her death. The title Poppies in October immediately raises the question as if the poetess is only talking about flowers, as she used poppies flowers in a metaphorical meaning. The poet declares that poppies petals are like scars of any women. Poppies are the symbol of Remembrance Day, the day which is celebrated in the remembrance or memory of the soldiers who died in the First World War. So versatile things are indicated in this poem. The structure, this is a four stanza poem, three lines in each. So total 12 lines, written in free verse, scant language. Major themes are contrast between life and death, and between joy and pain, and between male and female. Poetic devices are symbolism, imagery, irony, rhetorical question, and tone is very simple, subjective and personal, as Plath expresses her own personal point of view in this poem. So now we are in lesson 3, Ariel. So Ariel is a mythological character, that is the meaning of which is the lioness of God. Oh, the lioness of God. Here, to Ariel, Plath presents a horse on which she rides, on back of which she rides. So in the avatar of a horse, this is actually the lioness of God. So why Plath used this title in this poem? Let's see. Ariel depicts a woman riding her horse in the countryside. At the very break of dawn, it details the ecstasy and personal transformation that occurs through the experience. The poem begins with complete immobility in the darkness while the rider waits on the horse. This poem describes the terror of a wild horseback ride and the mental and emotional transformation that the rider, the speaker, goes through as she faces death. So this is a turning point between life and death. So human being are fighting with death like a soldier. And a soldier needs a horse like a knight to fight better in the battlefield. So the battlefield is the field between life and death, symbolically or metaphorically. The poem begins with a calm stasis in which nothing is happening until the horse Ariel throws herself headlong into a church. Even the title Ariel is a feministic name, I mean female's name, female horse. Okay, so all the things are feminine. Analysis. Ariel was written on Sylvia Plath's 13th birthday, October 27, 1962, before her death, and published posthumously, I mean after her death, in the collection Ariel in 1965. Ariel translates to Lion of God, the Lioness of God, from Hebrew, and Plath refers to herself as God's Lioness in line 4. Though it's Lion of God, but Plath refers it to God's Lioness, I mean feminine gender. The genre, it is a confessional poetry as it draws upon a real life experience. And the type, it is an autobiographical, feminist and psychological poem. Structure, Ariel is composed in blank verse of 10 three-line stanzas. three-line stanzas with an additional single line at the end. That means 31 lines and follows an unusual slanted rhyme scheme. The setting, it is set in a lush countryside during the early hours of the morning. Poetic devices which are used in this poem are alliteration, consonants, assonance, metaphor, simile, irony, metonymy, synecdoche, personification, hyperbole, onomatopoeia, and pararhyme. And major themes, motility, transcendence, feministic spirit, and female power. And the tone, the dominant tone, is frightening and chaotic, interspersed with moments of exhilaration and joyful energy. As it is a poem which symbolizes fighting against death. Protagonist and antagonist. The protagonist is the unnamed person, while the antagonist is the frantic runaway horse, or perhaps the speaker's whole life she is trying to escape, or the nair about death. So now we have come to lesson 4, Waking in Winter. Waking in winter. Winter season is a symbol of roughness, is a symbol of lifelessness, barrenness. So let's see what barrenness Plath is expressed in this poem. The barrenness of mind, the emotional depth is depicted in this poem. Waking in Winter by Sylvia Plath describes a natural landscape, a hotel, and those who reside there as hopeless and loveless, like they are living in a prison. So human body is a prison, while the mind is death. Like we are living in quarantine in the corona period, or COVID-19 pandemic. So this is something like that. Though we are living, but we are living a lifeless life, without any joy, without any ecstasy, always with anxiety and worries. So we can compare this poem with the pandemic situation which is going on now. In the first line of Waking in Winter, the sky is spotted as hard, cold and sleek, and the trees are relayed to reader as stiff as he burnt knobs. So all the natural things which are soft, which are lively, but depicted as harsh, as hard like metal. Why? Why Plath express this natural beautiful things as lifeless and harsh and hard, metal like hard, not soft like leaves of trees? Because the life is harsh, the mind is dead. With these descriptions, Plath intended convey space that is devoid of feeling. It has all been burnt up. The nerves which are responsible for feeling within the human body are destroyed. The nerves. Okay, the emotion is dead and destroyed in the body. So the body is now robotic. Robotic body has no value. No value. In the fourth line, she takes the reader into her dreams and speaks about destruction, annihilations. So all the sufferings, oil-like stuffs are consuming, annihilate and destruct all the lively things, joys, ecstasy, and exotic things of life, and make our mind dead. It soon becomes clear that the speaker and the companion are taking a car trip to a resort, but the places they pass are dark, poison, and speak of death. Eventually, they get to the resort, and the speaker describes cow-like people looking at the views, an emotionless nurse standing to those in residence there. The whole poem feels colorless, loveless, and hopeless. Death is the reigning power in the world Plath has created. analysis of this poem, Walking in Winter by Sylvia Plath is a two stanza poem that is separated into two sets of 8 lines or octaves, 16 lines in total. Major themes are escapism, hopelessness, lovelessness, brutality of the First World War and the horrific Second World War. Which are the symbols of greatest horrific events? And death, poetic devices, assonance, alliteration in German and imagery. See those in Dictionary of Literary Terms and the term subjective and personal as other poems of Plath. That's all. We have reached the end of the lesson. Thank you very much. See you and talk to you with another lesson next week. Thank you very much. Bye-bye. Stay safe and stay home.